Thank you everyone for coming. I'm going to show you a short film before I start.
I never told anyone about that day. I was 13 years old. I was shocked. I didn't know what was happening to me. But I felt it. A man on the train, a complete stranger, touched me in a way that I knew was wrong. And I didn't say a thing about it. In fact, this happens every day in every city in India and around the world. And Indian women tend to stay silent. In December 2012, something happened that shook the country. A 23-year-old woman and her friend boarded a private bus. On that bus, there were six other men who, during that journey, beat her male friend up and then gang-raped her. They inserted metal rods into her body, pulled out her intestines, and dumped her on the side of the road. She ultimately died of her injuries. It took something like this, which was so brutal in nature, to force the conversation of sexual violence in the public domain. So many people wanted change. I wanted to do something too, and that's why I started Safecity. To me, the biggest problem was that women were not sharing their experiences of sexual violence, and we needed to break their silence. So Safecity was created as a safe space where women and girls could share their stories anonymously. These stories are then collated as location-based trends, which we could then visualize on a map as hotspots and put out into the public domain so that they could then use this information to improve their own safety. This is a new data set that the police don't have. And we share it with them on a regular basis so that they can increase their vigilance and change their beat patrol timings. We created workshops to educate the public on what constitutes sexual violence and their legal rights and responsibilities. And we have used innovative ways to eradicate it through targeted community involvement. Together, we can help women make a profound change in their lives, helping to make every city a safe city.
This mouse.
There it is.
Thank you very much for coming. You know, this incident that took place in December 2012, I'm sure you heard about it because it made the news all over the world. And at that point in time, I was actually in the aviation industry. I had a job in the corporate sector where I was working with one of India's leading airlines on network planning, that is route planning, deciding where to fly planes, etc., how many times to fly. And data was a large part of my job. And we used to use historical data to make future predictions. And this is pretty much what I've kind of done with Safecity. What I found was that when this incident happened, for the first time in India, we started talking about it openly. Wherever we went, whether it was in a public setting or a private setting, in the newspapers, on television, all the discussion was only about this gang rape and how brutal it was. And for the first time, I heard my own friends share their own stories, which until then, no one had spoken about it, even amongst us girlfriends. I was reminded of my own stories, including the one of me on the train, but there were so many others like that, you know. And to my shock, when I started to investigate the issue, I found that this is a sexual pandemic. It's a global pandemic, where on an average, 1 in 3 women around the world experience some form of it at least once in their lifetime. And yet, 80% of us choose not to talk about it. Now, in my country, in India, and maybe on a higher scale, you know, close to 100%. In places like Sweden, which I think is a very egalitarian country, it's 1 in 5 women, which is still 20%. In the US, it's 1 in 4, which is 25%. I think the numbers are shocking. And most of these actually happen before the age of 16. It's not only girls that are sexually harassed, but also boys. And we don't even talk about that. But my work is focused primarily on women and girls, because I think there's a complete silence around this issue, and you know, I want to change that. If you look at some of the India statistics, the National Crime Bureau says that, you know, according to their data, there's a rape every 20 minutes. But this is a study that one of the organizations did in Delhi, and it says that almost 75% of women and girls face sexual violence in their own neighborhoods. It's not in some other place, you know, it's literally where they live. 9 out of 10 reported experienced sexual aggression or violence, that is ranging from obscene comments to being groped, stalked, or sexually assaulted in public spaces. And almost 65% of these women and girls felt fearful or extremely fearful when they go out alone at night. Half of the men surveyed said that they had sexually harassed or been violent with a woman in a public space at least once in their lifetime. And male respondents blamed women for being the cause of harassment, with 3 out of 4 men agreeing with the statement, "Women provoke men by the way they dress." 5 men partially or fully agreed that women moving around at night deserve to be sexually harassed. This is just one of the surveys that was done, and this was done before that gang rape, just 6 months before that gang rape. So, you know, when I started working on it, on this issue, I realized that actually sexual violence is a whole spectrum of abuse. Often when we talk about it, we only talk about sexual assault and rape, which is on one end of the spectrum. And on a daily basis, we tend to ignore the non-verbal and verbal forms of it, deeming them to be too trivial, when in fact they could be extremely debilitating to many, limiting choices, limiting opportunities, restricting mobility, and affecting mental health. But because we normalize it, we accept it, and we are told to deal with it, you know. So what happens is, it starts off with, you know, just objectifying a woman, then it becomes degrading, and that leads to assault. It's literally a slippery slope where your well-being is constantly under pressure, and then, you know, you as the victim don't really know how to deal with it. We did a study ourselves in Bombay. This is our own pictures. And some of the stories, you know, it says, "I had a really scary encounter in Dombivli, which is a suburb, in an auto." An auto is a rickshaw, you know, a scooter. I don't know how many of you have been to Asia. A tuk-tuk. "The driver stopped to pick up his friend and then rode past my destination. This was at 10 p.m. I felt so intimidated and helpless. They finally laughed and dropped me off ahead. It was just a 5-minute walk from my home, but it was terrifying. I just wanted to go home after a long day at work, but instead I was feeling so scared and unsafe. Feeling safe is not a luxury," says this woman. And this other lady says, "I was with my 14-year-old sister walking to the station in Vikhroli, which is another suburb, when I felt unsafe and scared. A group of young boys started saying things like, 'Kya chal rahi hai yahan,' which is basically catcalling, and harassing us. This was in the afternoon, in daylight, in a crowd of many people. No one said anything. I turned around and gave them some galis, which is a few abuses. And that's when everyone intervened. And they scolded me. They asked me why I was here. I felt so bad because I thought they would obviously side with me. How can we even go to the police when no one supports us in public? So really, it's this creation of this societal, social-cultural norm which creates an insecure culture, where often the victim who's experiencing sexual violence in a public space does not really get any support from the bystanders around her. She feels compelled to keep silent. Often, in many cultures, the blame comes back to the victim. What were you wearing? You were wearing the wrong clothing. You were in the wrong place at the wrong time. You provoked the incident from happening. And so you start really questioning whether you were the one who brought it on. And nobody supports you. So you feel compelled to keep silent. You don't go to the police or any other official authority to make a complaint. As a result, the official statistics do not reflect the true nature and size of the problem, thus making the problem invisible in a way. Law enforcement does not act, because they don't have sufficient data. And again, you know, it creates this whole cycle. This is the only crime, I think, where the victim is put under the scanner and not the perpetrator. Imagine if you were robbed. Who would we go after? You or the robber? The robber, right? But when it comes to a crime of sexual violence, it's often the victim who has to justify why she was not at fault. And that, to me, I think is wrong. So my response was, you know, to start Safecity, which is a crowd map for sexual violence in public spaces. We had heard about something similar being done in Egypt. And at the time, I thought, what an interesting project. But I did not think it was urgent enough for me to start it in India. But post that gang rape, I felt, yes, we need more voices. We need to be able to bring these stories to light. And so we launched it. We use open source technology, which was very easy to put it together. Literally 5 days post the incident and 10 days after we launched it. And one can zoom in right up to the street level to see what's going on. This is Delhi. The report itself is very simple. We ask what happened, where it happened, the date and time. You don't even have to leave your name and email. And there are many ways that we've made it possible to report. The web app, now we have a mobile app which is available on Android and iOS in English, Hindi, and Spanish. But we also made it easy for those who don't have internet and mobile access. In India, we have a missed call facility where people can call a number, it gets disconnected, we call them back and get their story. They can also get in touch with us on Facebook and Twitter. And we also have an email. Usually, people who write to us or call us up, they're not reporting sexual violence in public spaces. They're talking about domestic violence, child sex abuse, sexual harassment at the workplace, basically where the perpetrator is known to them. What I find interesting is when you read these stories, it's very important to read these stories, and you can query it based on date range, you can query it based on the categories. So we've broken it down. And you know, when I was doing one of my sessions in the US, this lady actually came to me and said, you know, this is a vocabulary you've given us. Because till then, you know, if you just use a broad term sexual harassment or sexual violence, people assume it to be assault and rape. But when you break it down into categories, you're actually giving it a vocabulary, giving a vocabulary to the crime, and it's easier to talk about it. But it's also easier for us to analyze it. So you can comment on it as well. And reading these stories is very important. I think storytelling is super critical. How many of you are following the MeToo hashtag on social media? You are, right? How many of your friends have put MeToo but not shared their story? A lot, right? And that, to me, says we have a lot more work to do, because these are women who have access to the internet, they are literate, they have access to resources, yet they don't feel comfortable sharing their story. And Me Too actually validates our work, because what was the call out? The call to action was anyone who's experienced any form of sexual violence, put it up on social media so that we can see the magnitude of the problem. And we are seeing the magnitude of the problem. Every day, somewhere in the world, a powerful person is being held accountable for his actions. Right now, I don't think there's any case where a her has to resign from her job. But really, it's to show the magnitude. But, you know, I'll give you an example. I was doing a session in one of the girls' colleges in Bombay, and we do this exercise where we plot out on a map and we visually see where these things are happening. And when they were telling their stories, one of the girls said, you know, I always thought it was only happening to me. I'm surprised and shocked that it's happening to everyone. So the storytelling is so important, because when you hear that you're not alone, your whole perspective towards the problem changes. The second thing is, when you see it on a map and you can plot it and see that it's not one woman's story on that, in that location, but so many have happened at the same time, again, you're compelled to find out, what is it about that location that makes it the comfort zone of the perpetrator? Can we change that? So crowdsourced data, I think, is very important. And we use this technology. I think technology makes our life a lot simpler. One is, you know, it gives us access to information so that we can raise our own situational awareness and make better choices for our safety. How many of you use TripAdvisor? How many of you use Yelp? What are those? Those are peer review mechanisms, right? People share their experiences in a hotel, in a restaurant, and based on that, you decide whether you want to stay there, eat there. Even you have Goodreads for books, you have something for movies. You're not going to waste your precious time today on a crappy movie. So why can't we learn from each other? I'll give you another example. I was in San Francisco for meetings, and it was recommended to us to have a meeting in one of the co-working spaces in downtown. We were two of us. I had a conflicting meeting in procedure. I ended up there, beautiful space. When I met my colleague later, she was completely white and shaken. And I said, what happened? And she said, I just took a left and a right and I ended up in a bad neighborhood. And so she had to evacuate from there and change the location of her meeting. Later, when we're talking to people, they said, nobody walks in that part of San Francisco. But how were we to know? Especially if it was recommended to us. Yet nobody thought to tell us that, listen, don't walk there, take public transport or whatever. You know, we would have been better prepared. So learning from each other, you can make better choices. You can also use this information to mobilize your communities to find solutions in your own neighborhood. The very first thing that I did when I started Safecity, since I didn't come from the women's movement, nor had majored in gender studies, and had absolutely no background doing this work, I volunteered with an organization in Bombay that was trying to mobilize communities around an issue. I convinced them, pick public safety and I'll work with you. And within 6 months, we had one of our first success stories. We had several interviews with the residents of a small neighborhood across 10 streets. One of the dominant trends that came out was chain snatching. Now in India, we all love our gold. Most of us wear gold chains. And this was targeted towards not just women, but also men, but women are in particular vulnerable. With just 20 data points, we were able to, 20 data points in a 6 month period, we were able to convince the police to change their beat patrol timings. They couldn't dispute with this data. And those 20 data points or 20 stories didn't even result in an official complaint at the police station. The people felt, you know, forget the gold chain, I don't want to deal with the police. Because police are seen as insensitive, the judicial process is so lengthy to, you know, you don't want to waste your time. But what they did was, not only did we present to the police and the police change their beat patrol timings, the police assistant commissioner called up his counterpart in the municipal corporation, got him to fix the street lighting, trim the trees that were blocking the light. Then we had the elected representative calling us and saying, why didn't you come to me? I have budgets for women's safety. And since the residents knew where this was happening, they could dictate where the CCTV cameras were, could be positioned. And, you know, they felt so empowered. It kind of made the relation between the police and the community better, but between the residents themselves, they felt that they could collectively do something, where at an individual level, sometimes you feel very alone. And for the police themselves, it's a new data set. We've had the police tell us that they were already scanning our website for trends, and that's how we ended up working with them. We send a monthly dashboard to the police in Delhi, Bombay, and in Goa. The Delhi police asked us to come and explain our data. We sat in their office for a week, and they admitted that they had never seen data like that. And they then invited us to be part of their program in schools, where they did self-defense and we were doing gender sensitization. This is a wall mural in Delhi at a busy main road where there was a tea stall. Now, a tea stall in India is a kiosk where they sell tea, and it's usually a male-dominated space. You hardly see any women drinking tea and loitering around. But men would loiter there whilst drinking their tea and intimidate the women and girls passing by with their comments and their male gaze, the constant male gaze. And when we, what we do is when we work with the community, for our Oxfam colleagues, we kind of build a capacity to understand the spectrum of abuse, the legislation that makes it a crime, and then we invite them to share their stories. As the stories keep coming, we kind of study the patterns and trends and what are these hotspots. So we presented it back to the community and we said, okay, this is a hotspot. This is where it's happening. What do you want to do about it? We don't dictate solutions. And they said, we would like the staring and commenting to stop. Now, how do you do that in a culture where it's difficult to actually challenge a man or say it directly? So we organized an art workshop and they painted staring eyes and subtle messaging, which loosely translates in English to look with your heart, not with your eyes. We won't be intimidated by your gaze. Raise your voice. And this is a long wall mural. And it was so effective that the staring and loitering actually stopped. And you know, I constantly give interviews. Some journalists actually went there to check it out. And they asked the tea stall guy, do people hang around over here? And he says, no. We know now that it's intimidating, so we tell them move on, you know. I think that's very powerful when the community can come together and stand in solidarity with you. Because, you know, not everything requires police intervention, but this is very easy to solve. And, you know, for many of the women and girls, they are illiterate. But painting that wall and sharing their feelings was really empowering. And then seeing the change in their own neighborhood helped them to take it forward. This is another wall mural outside a public toilet, again in Delhi. In those communities, they do not have toilets within their home. This is a public toilet and probably the only toilet that a woman has access to, because unlike the man, she doesn't go out to work. We've had several cases where these public toilets are hotspots. One of them was completely locked. So our data kept showing that the women were being attacked when they went to the bushes to do their daily business. And we were like, but there's a public toilet there. Little realizing that that public toilet was actually locked. And so we used the data to get the municipal corporation to open and maintain and clean it. But this public toilet, where this wall mural was, it had no proper doors, no proper windows, and no proper lighting for the women's part of it. And on top of that, the young men had put a couch outside the toilet, would sit down there and intimidate them with their comments, and they would take MMS clips. Of course, you don't know what they are going to do with it. So they painted this, and they also put sections of the law on the side. And within a week, the couch disappeared, and the young men actually joined the campaign and started advocating for change amongst their own peers. And to me, that was very powerful, because I feel, because of the silence around this issue, we often don't talk to the young men and the boys in our community. And we can get them involved if we start having a dialogue and a discussion. And when they realize that there is actually pain involved, there's so much of negativity that one experiences, maybe they might have a shift in their attitude and behavior. And we've seen data to be very powerful in that. This is actually one of the young men. But on an everyday basis, we work with several youth, 50% of whom are young men and boys. I want to give you another example again in Delhi. A lot of our work is in Delhi because we've done a lot of community work in the local gender resource centers there. But this is a sabha, a community gathering. So this was when we collected data, we invited them and we asked them, okay, what do you want to do about it? And they said, we want to invite the police to hear about it. So they invited the local police. And they actually told him, you know, what are you doing about this? Because we have a lot of sexual harassment in our neighborhood. And he said, but we don't have any of these in our official statistics. There is no proof. They gave him 200 copies of the reports on our site, and he actually accepted it, changed his beat patrol timing, increased vigilance, and invited them to even come to the police station, which we did. And I was there in Delhi at that time. I live in Bombay. And he very nicely explained the working of the police, and he invited them and said, please feel free to walk in any time and make a complaint or tell us what's going on. And I think that is very critical because, you know, we see police as insensitive, brutal, people we can't approach, but we may need their help, and we do need their help. And if there is no trust between community and police, how do we bridge that gap? I think this can help. This is in Kathmandu. So when I started this work in India, I'm part of several women's organizations, and Vital Voices is one of them. So one of the areas that they work on is eradicating violence against women and girls in all forms. And so I was at a conference where I had partners from around the world, and they said, can we use your platform? And I said, sure, please go ahead. So the one in Nepal started using it, and she wanted to prove that public transportation in Kathmandu was not safe for women and girls. In Kathmandu, unlike other capital cities, they only have minibuses, which means that if it's meant for 25 people, they shove 50 people there. And you can imagine women are groped, and that's how they get to work or their normal routine. So yes, the data did prove that, and she was able to convince the transportation authorities to issue women-only bus licenses, and she had one flying on the busiest bus route in Kathmandu till the earthquake struck. So we had a Safecity bus in Kathmandu running around. And this is in Kenya. We work in Kibera, which is one of the largest slums in Nairobi. Our partner organization collected a lot of data. We identified a lot of hotspots. This is where Google Maps doesn't even work. You know, in Kibera, there are only streets. So people would report saying, near the pink mosque, near the big building, near this. And so we would kind of cluster the data and visually see how it looked, ask our partner to provide context. One of the hotspots where young girls on their way to school were being groped was near a mosque. So we invited the imam when they were, you know, talking about the data, showed him the data. He incorporated it in his sermons, and that was really effective in, getting the young men to stop, indulging in this kind of behavior. Then they went one step forward and said, okay, who are these young men? So they turned out to be juveniles who had already, kind of indulged in petty robbery and gone to jail. And they knew that that was not what they wanted. They didn't want to go to jail a second time, so they had stopped doing it. They did not realize that sexual harassment is actually a crime. So they were educated, told that, you know, there's fine or there's jail time involved. And that also had an effect. So what have we achieved so far? Close to 11,000 stories. We have random reports from Kyrgyzstan to Mexico to Morocco. But what I find is if you have a partner locally who has convening power in the community, can raise a lot more of these reports in a concentrated location, that will help you understand the pattern and trends. Through the data that we've collected, we have engaged over 400,000 citizens, police, municipal authorities, transportation authorities, etc. We conduct workshops educating people, right from children to adults, to youth, to corporates, on prevention of sexual harassment in their settings and understanding the laws. We are now present in 10 countries through partners, And we work with three police forces. In fact, we now have the Delhi Railway Police who've approached us asking us to help them improve the safety on the metro line. Ours is a very low-cost solution. It complements our online, offline, because I don't believe that just putting technology out there works. You have to be able to use it in a community-based setting or with an institution. But you know, just leaving it out there will not solve the problem. We focus on individual action, so we encourage everyone to be an active bystander. If you remember that cycle of insecure cultures, one of the ways of breaking it is if each of us thinks how we can intervene and prevent it from happening. There are many ways. If you see it happening, say, you know, speak up, get the person out of the situation, call the police. That's the easiest thing to do. Or raise an alarm. I say this because nowadays what we find in India is when it's happening, people are more interested in recording it on their phone, but they will not call the police. I think call the police and then do whatever you have to do. Community engagement. Community, we're all part of some community. You're part of a student community or the residential community. And I think we can complement police efforts by making sure that the community itself decides that they do not want it to happen in their neighborhood. And of course, institutions, whether it's an educational institution, police, or municipal authority. So police, we help them identify where this is happening because this is not a data set that they would have. It complements their regular data set. I don't know about y'all, but in my country, if you access the data, it's very top level. It's probably at the city level, never at the street level, at least not the one that's available to us. And for the school and college administration, again, you can use it to prevent sexual violence on campuses. For elected representatives who have budgets for safety, we as citizens can dictate and demand accountability on how those budgets are spent. And of course, in many countries, so in, like for example, Cameroon, we collected a set of data and then we found out that they don't even have legislation on public space harassment. So now we are trying to get that data to influence legislation. We are present on social media. We think it's a great tool to raise awareness and build up people's capacity to talk about it, because I feel we still have a lot of work to do because of the shame involved. Till we create an environment where every person can own their story and feel comfortable talking about it, we're still not going to be able to have the data that is required to solve this problem. So we have Twitter chats, and every Friday, 9 p.m. Indian Standard Time, we kind of have a one-hour tweet chat. We invite people like yourselves to come and take over our handle. As a result, we have close to 180,000 followers. On Facebook also, we have 44,000 followers. We invite blog posts just to have this conversation that is broader and from different perspectives. And we have several exciting projects in the pipeline for next year. We're going to be working with the Delhi Railway Police, to make the railway safer. Rural Maharashtra, we are primarily urban at this point, but we are going to be working in rural Maharashtra for the first time with the government of Maharashtra. We are working with two city councils, hopefully in the future, one in Argentina and one in Sweden, which is exciting for me because they want to address the larger thing on public safety and not just women's safety. And then a couple of universities, one in the UK, in Southampton, and one in the US. We're doing an urban planning study in Mumbai because we want to understand what are those things that can easily be incorporated into urban planning that, from a gender perspective, that can make it safer for women and girls in the city. If it's safe for them, I think it's safe for everyone. And of course, safe bars. Whilst we believe that, women should be able to go out and access all the opportunities for themselves to live a full life, why not even be safe when you are having fun? And yeah, so that brings me to the end of the presentation. If you believe like I do that every public space should be safe for women and girls in order to achieve their potential, whether it's economic or otherwise, I think we have to combine our efforts to do that. And these are my coordinates. So we have about 20 minutes for questions.
pretty glass of water if you want.
Yeah, thank you.